Recorded Books and RB Digital present Food of the Gods by Cassandra Khaw, narrated by Jonathan Yen. Part 1. Rupert Wong, Cannibal Chef. 1.
You can't unionize. If you unionize, you'll...
I feel jaw muscles tighten from the impending awkwardness. You'll make demonic undead babiness look viable. I slump. The words hang like the absence of applause at the end of an ill-considered comedy routine. Luckily, my audience isn't the type to heckle. Instead, they stare, a violence of gold-green eyes dangling from the ceiling, unblinking, uncurious. I used to wonder if death kills your sense of humor. It does. At least when it comes to the Kuikia. I've never heard any of these ghost kids laugh.
Why not?
The voices wood rot and maggot bodies convulsing in ecstasy. Heartworms boiling out of an old junkyard dog.
You said to protect your own.
I scratch the back of my neck, shrug, and make pointless noises. I neither need nor want to be splitting hairs with them. In 2 hours, the boss is expecting a feast to end all feasts, which means I'll need to very quickly figure out how to process obese Caucasian while organizing the refreshments. Guan Yin, forgive me, but the first actually galls me less than the second. Meat is meat by any other name. Plus, the excess of available lard means I can put Penang delicacies on the menu, something that will no doubt delight the guests who keep halal. Human is very similar to pork, after all.
I know.
Religious pundits say that cannibalism is forbidden in the Quran anyway. The ghouls say that this isn't quite the same. As for the beverages, I can't say I'm looking forward to the process. The blood will need to be segregated and decanted into custom Swarovski vials, cross-checked against autopsy records and attractively labeled. The boss abhors bad handwriting to ensure no one confuses the selection. It's all tedious busy work, coupled with the vague risk of infection. I blame it on the fad burning through the northern Penanggalans. They've made HIV into the it flavor. It's a bloody mess. Get used to it, Ong Ma. The juicy hot dog of life is best enjoyed between two puns.
Yes, but unionizing is going to encourage those Taoist priests and Bomas and what have yous to make even more of you,
I tell them as I sift through the spice rack. Cardamom. Is cardamom an anathema to any of the guests?
Genetic diversity is good,
declares one of the Kuikia, his voice like a hornet's nest, humming with importance.
We need to consolidate resources against larger threats.
Only if you breed, which you shouldn't do, because you're underaged and shit. Also, dead. I'm tripping over my tongue and my thoughts, but I can't help it. Tact isn't my forte. And where did you even learn? Their glittering stares tell me everything.
Oh, right. I taught you that, right. Shit.
I press the heel of a hand into my left eye where a dull ache is taking root behind the socket. Anyway, tell you what. Let's talk later. Tonight, even. Come find me. I peel my sleeve back and expose my wrist. There's a patch of skin on the inside, still naked of demonic tenants. I'll explain that later. Proof that I'm not completely drowning in the red. The Kuikiad don't hesitate. One by one, they detach, moth silent, from the ceiling, to land on my forearm. Say what you will about these little bastard sons and daughters of the grave, but they're amazingly courteous. No one jostles for access. No one tries to drain me dry. They all consume exactly one small mouthful of blood, just enough to keep my scent in their noses. The last even goes as far as to lick the opened vein close. So polite. Their mothers would be proud. Having acquired their thimble of bodily fluids, the Kuikiad disperse, scuttling through gaps in the masonry and openings in the roof. They're like cats, in that respect, capable of navigating spaces you'd think were too small for their decay-plumped bodies. A Bama friend of mine said it has something to do with how they are made. By nature, fetuses lack the tensile skeletal structure that adults enjoy. Mix that physiological quirk in with some blasphemous juju, the natural consequences of putrefaction, and you get some, well, you get these guys. Still, they were legion, and I am but one. Rupert Wong, superstar chef to the ghouls and liaison for the damned of Kuala Lumpur. By the time the air stops reeking of frangipani, I'm giddy from blood loss. My fingers tingle, my head swims. But these are just inconveniences, minor obstacles to be overcome in the pursuit of the month's rent. Speaking of which, I pick up the tools of my office. Bone saw, cleaver, garden shears for those hard-to-crack ribs, before wobbling unsteadily towards the walk-in freezer. Inside, a 300-pound tourist and his generously proportioned wife await. Day jobs. Love them.
Sayang, you're late.
The world is made up of rituals. From the way you brush your teeth to how you show obeisance during religious ceremonies, it's an endless list of interlocking behaviors seared into your unconscious self. Charms against the madness of reality. Mina and I have them, same as anyone. I come home the exact same way each day. Hours too late and smelling abattoir sweet. My clothes speckled with gore. Mina then reprimands me the same way she has every evening since we moved in together, softly and without malice, her voice like the sunlight piercing the belly of the monsoon rains. I invariably follow up with a smile, sometimes an apology, before locking the door and checking it thrice. It's an unusual door, with bolts and padlocks to keep the meth heads out, yellow paper talismans to keep Mina and her boy in. I'm not trading in hyperbole when I say I check it thrice. I really do. Once for habit, twice for caution, three times for love. Mina still has nightmares about picking tendons from her teeth, about her bloodlust flinging her over a shoulder and running off to an orgiastic frenzy of people-eating. She can't sleep if the wards aren't in mint condition. "Sorry, kitten," I say, tired, turning around to pick my way to the kitchen. "It was dinner for 30 today." Our home is neither large nor lavishly appointed. In another life, it might have been called Scandinavian chic, with its armament of IKEA furniture, austere color scheme, and Mina's one signed poster of Alexander Skarsgård. But right now, there's just too much clutter. Too many pieces of magical paraphernalia littering the walls and the floor for it to be called anything but livable. To be fair, most of it is concentrated around the doorway to our guest bedroom turned office, but it's impossible to walk 3 feet without stumbling over a prayer book or a Bagua mirror.
You've worked with 30 before, Mina replies quietly.
Yeah, but not with fat white people. I lean against the doorway, cross my arms, and waggle a finger. The air is thick with spices. Turmeric, cumin, sautéed garlic. I cooked American today. Mina turns from the stove. She looks about 19. She was 19 when they put her in the ground, belly ripe with child. 6 months later, she clawed her way free of the earth and stalked down her cheating wretch of a spouse. Then she gobbled him up, bones, balls, and all. Him and the bitch he poisoned her for. She spoons a lock of dark hair behind an ear and smiles, lips a curved bow with no teeth.
And?
Damn it. Mina always knows when I'm holding something back. Something on the ceiling lets loose a mad little hiss. Half lizard and half wasp, all feed me your liver with lima beans. Mina glances up, serene, mouth touched with apology. It's been 5.5 years, but she's still beating herself up over our ineptitude at domestication. And how's my little dude? I raise my arms. It drops like a coconut, and I catch it between my open hands and hold it as far from my face as I can manage. It scratches at the air and hisses again, louder this time, blind fish eyes twitching. Mina's baby is a tragic anomaly. Because it died in her womb, it is irrevocably tethered to her existence, as much a part of her being as her fingers and toes. Because it died before it could even be born, it's broken. Bad.
He's a little hungry, I'm afraid.
Ah, I say, careful not to express anything that could be construed as strong emotion. Feeding time is awkward enough as it is. Okay, I gotcha. No worries. Over the years, I've gotten good at being a surrogate father/demon child wrangler. I wait for Mina's baby. In my brain, its name is George, to become distracted before I make my move. When a wail from the kettle grabs its attention, I pull George to my chest and wedge its head underneath an armpit, careful to keep its limbs tightly pinioned. It squirms ferociously, anger pouring off its wet little body, but it doesn't fight me for long. When I present my wrist, biology takes over. George sinks its needle teeth deep into a vein and begins suckling blood like it was ambrosia from Zeus's tit. What about you? I look up from the sanity-eradicating tableau that is George's bedtime snack. You need, topping up? Mina shakes her head, voice stiff.
I'm not a glutton.
Okay, just checking, I reply, adjusting the distribution of weight in my arms.
If I squint hard enough, if I fight hard enough against my mind's objections, George can almost pass for a normal infant.
The lies we tell ourselves, Ma, honestly. Mina and I find an old silence together. I settle into a chair, still cradling George, and fidget with the old-fashioned radio on the dining table. She fusses over dinner. Under Mina's skillful hands, the aromas condense into identifiable names. Yogurty chicken korma and stir-fried paku-pakis drenched in belachan. Confections summoned from coconut milk and pandan extract. We don't talk,
only listen to the noises that domesticity make. Led Zeppelin joins in after a squeal of static, singing about heaven and ways to buy redemption. And for a little while, my world borders on normal. But then the air fills with frangipani again, sweet and cloying like Goudin Graham's cigarettes, and all that tranquility goes away. I jolt upright and scan the seams of the building for the telltale flicker of tiny fingers, the flash of yellow-green eyes. None emerge, but I can feel the crush of their attention. Siang? And so can Mina, it seems. Are you expecting guests tonight? I nod as I detach George from my wrist. It comes off with a slurp and a gasp, its complaints reduced to aggressive burblings. I leave George on the table and bind the wound with a kitchen rag, fingers compressed over the serrated wound. The checkered fabric blooms crimson. The Kui Kia want to, unionize. Mina raises an eyebrow. It's remarkably expressive. I raise my hands, abashed. Don't say it. I shouldn't have read them, those business manuals. I know, just I'm learning to be better about doing stupid things. I swear. Deliberately and silently, she returns to her cooking. I wilt under the weight of her disapproval, but there's no time to court her forgiveness. Guiltily, I skulk out of the kitchen and into my office, where it is dark and rich in bright, unblinking eyes.
"You're late, Mr. Wong,"
whispers one of the Kui Kia. "Yeah, well, bite me." A heartbeat passes before I realize what I've just said. I raise my index finger. Metaphorically. 2. Let's take it a step back, Ong Ma. Let's talk about what I do in the evenings. You already know I cut up tourists to make splendiferous banquets for ravenous abominations in custom-fitted Armani suits. But why do I waste my time with undead babies when I could be making sweet music with my darling Mina? I'm sure there's a crack to be made somewhere in that last sentence. Don't take the bait, Ong Ma. You're better than that. The answer is simple. Mutual benefit. I did some bad things in my youth. Real bad. Like rob your mama and stab your cousin bad. All of which came to a head when I turned 24. I was up to my neck in unhappy ghosts, each and every one of them saddled with complaints so heavy, I remember being shocked I could stand upright. One night, after many, many sleepless nights, I gave in and called a priest. And what he said? Well, it was a lot like being told you have cancer. Somewhere, somehow, on a primal level, you knew something is dangerously wrong, but you try to ignore it. The lump in your right testicle, the invasive mole, the inexplicable sudden weight loss. You let yourself pretend that borrowed time isn't borrowed unless you publicly admit it's a loan. But then the voice of reason cuts through all your delusions. The ugly truth gets yanked out like a tapeworm from the brain. And you cry. You wail at the ugliness of it, the unfairness, the shock of being mortal. But deep down, though, none of it really surprises you. You always knew this was how it had to go down. The holy man didn't tell me anything I wasn't already expecting. He said I had an express pass to all 10 courts of hell. I would be there for 1,000 years, if I was lucky. Longer, more likely.
I wasn't just damned. I was fucked. After pickling myself in cheap liquor, I did what any reasonable guy would do. I called up DU. I'll tell you how some other time, Hangmo, and asked if there was any way I could negotiate to get time off for good behavior. They said yes. So now I'm working off my karmic debt through community management. I mediate arguments. I listen to complaints. I exercise stubborn ghouls. I push pencils on hell paper and do the books every hungry ghost festival. And sometimes I listen to dead fetuses expound on the necessities of a government-sanctioned union. Look, guys, you're forgetting one very important thing here. You're not free agents. Under, let's see. I rifle through a grimoire, trying to ignore the chicken skin texture of human leather against my palms. Yeah, okay. Under Article 3.152, you are contractors under independent enterprises. Unless you get explicit permission from your employers, you cannot establish a union. The Kuikia exchange fish-eyed stares. They blink, moist and loud.
That is where you come in, yes?
Me? A buzzsaw symphony of assent.
Yes!
I put the tome down, rub a knuckle into an eye, and work on pretending I'm still an indomitable professional. No, the food doesn't concern me, and I'd much prefer the Kuikia's company to the lukewarm embrace of my loving langsuer. Why, do you ask? I square my shoulders and fold my arms. No! Outside, gray collects, smog thick, across the city skyline, a haze of moisture veined with flashes of lightning. I count the seconds under my breath. 8, 9, 10. Thunder purrs. The Kuikia exhibit no concern. One slithers closer, head twisted at an eye-watering angle.
Why?
Its cranium revolves further.
Are you not our representative? Are you not our liaison?
Yes, and yes, but that isn't the point. Another plunges from the ceiling, loose draperies of skin flapping, to land atop the antique table lamp presiding over my desk.
We must unionize. It is the only way. Foreign competition is seeking to invade our market. If we do not present a united...
My hands jump up in defense. No, no, no! No! Wait, no! First of all, what... foreign competition. That doesn't make any sense. DU won't allow it. And I know the Jade Emperor isn't going to sign off on a refugee plan.
We must consolidate,
the Kuikia shriek in disharmony. You keep saying that, but I don't think you understand the words. My voice cracks into something undignified. But the Kuikia aren't having any of it. Without warning, the kid on my lamp lurches into the air, knocking it over so that it detonates into a million terracotta pieces. The rest follow, exploding in every direction, a frenzy of distended bellies and poison-bright gazes. Darkness hits like a fist. Now they're screaming, voices tangling, mixing into a slurry of punctuations and half-coherent exposition.
We must consolidate! The dog women lie! Not kind! Not kind! They come to eat and feast! So old! so powerful. Tear out our hearts, eat our livers, drink our blood. Punish us for the sins of our father. We will not allow. We must consolidate.
Before I know it, one of the Kuikia propels itself into my face. Dirty nails dig gutters across my cheeks and my nose. Grime-encrusted toes claw for purchase on my lips. I stumble backwards, stubbing my toe against the desk, and scream into moldering flesh. Terrible, terrible idea. A foot jams itself into my mouth, and I splutter as I try to rip the beast from my sideburns. Then, as quickly as it began, stillness. Nothing moves. Nothing speaks. Nothing so much as twitches a membrane. The Kuikia freeze, their attention riveted by the window. Even the one on my head presents no objection when I detach its grip and deposit it on my desk. Only rocks there, like a discarded voodoo doll, still and stiff. Something comes. The thought is cigarette burn hot, sudden as infant death. It hums under my skin like an itch. I suck in air. What? The Kuikia scatter, squirming into the cracks in the walls and the gaps in the ceiling, their eyes blinking out one after another. I glance over my shoulder, every hair on my body quivering on end, and take stock of the turbulent cloud formations and how they churn and writhe. Amoebic, snarling, hungry. The city is very, very dark now. The storm practically smeared across my... The world implodes with a muffled whoomph. The window crunches inwards, screams as it breaks. Silver glitters through the air. Fog boils through splintered glass. Too dense to be natural. Stinking of incense and salt and the smell of dead, drowned things. I throw myself over the desk and burrow into the alcove beneath, before curling armadillo tight, arms over my head. Forget machismo. Cowards live to breed to another day. A muscular shadow worms through the, out of the sky and onto the ceiling. There's a fusillade of claws. Clack, clack. Clack, clack. A sound like a heartbeat, ceaseless, systematic. Clack, clack, clack. I peek out. Up. Shit. Shit. Fuck. Kanasai Dew. Dragons are everywhere in Chinese mythology. Sinuous, slithering beasts with magnificent whiskers and incongruously stubby little limbs. Totally ridiculous looking next to their colonial cousins. What purpose, after all, could four fat legs serve on a 600-foot-long serpent? None, obviously. Except to make them a little less terrifying to their devotees. Real Chinese dragons are nothing like their literary depictions. Real Chinese dragons have faces that could launch a thousand traumas. They're fire-breathing, lightning-swilling centipedes with mouths full of knives. Mile-long Komodo dragons with scales and an attitude like a lungful of acid. Primordial monsters. Lovecraft's elder things squeezed through a lizard-shaped mold. Pre-BC shit. And one of them is now dangling over my head.
Rupert Wong.
Its voice is the song of the anglerfish, the rasp of the ocean storm, the moan of a sperm whale as it is ferried into the abyss, insides unspooling, slurped down by indescribable abominations. You know, I wet my lips. Hysteria feeds chemical courage into my veins, double dose of adrenaline. I am never, ever getting my deposit back on this place. Couldn't you have just knocked on the door like everyone else?
If you please us, you will never want for anything again.
Us. Not me. Us. The bottom of my abdomen opens and my entrails plummet through, yanking my throat tight. Horrified epiphany crawls up my vertebrae.
Serve us, and we will reward you.
Your Highness. My mouth is dry, dry, dry. This isn't just a dragon. This is a dragon king. The dragon king of the South Sea. Dolphin fucking Ouchin himself.
You are as good as they say you are, Rupert Wong.
Foghorn laugh that sinks halfway between that drawn-out syllable into something that verges on human.
You haven't wet yourself. We are impressed.
I look down. No point explaining. It was timing and not courage that held my bladder in check. Sure. The fog recedes, as does the stench of deep waters. Oil-black berlutis peep into view. I scuttle out from hiding as a foot begins to tap, my smile dangling like a loose eyeball. Soundless, the Dragon King has gone from nightmare to billionaire Bruce Wang, trading claws for cufflinks, arm-length teeth for an armory of pinstripes. Ouchin folds his arms as I straighten, before he nods with all the gravity of a god whose existence has never been in doubt, his eyes raking over my Tesco-bought wardrobe. So, to what do I owe this magnanimous visit? Despite my best efforts, my attention frays, skipping from his patrician visage to the waterlogged ruins of my office. This is going to cost thousands I don't have.
We wish to hire you.
Even in human form, his voice is strange and low, a heartbeat in the marrow.
We wish to borrow your services for an important duty.
Uh-huh. Sounds good. I rub my neck, skin pimpling under his yellow searchlight stare. Here's a trick to remember, Angmo. The supernatural can and will never completely hide who they are. And this comes with all the money I could possibly want for the rest of eternity, right? He grins. There are mandibles in the dark behind his teeth.
Yes.
Thou Chin croons, gliding closer.
All the treasures of Atlantis, all the wealth rotting in the South China Seas, all of it is yours, if you find what we want.
Okay. Uh-huh. Sounds good. I'm thinking about it. I gnaw on the inside of a cheek. I'm clenching and opening my hands, only half-consciously. Yeah, definitely thinking about it. But you gotta tell me what you want first. The air crisps with burning ozone.
No, we will not.
Alchin unwinds that last letter like a cartoon snake, spits each repetition with a resounding click.
We have already shown you great favor by not devouring your heart. We would not normally tolerate this show of disrespect.
Hindsight is always so incandescently clear. In retrospect, I probably should have kowtowed or curtsied or, better yet, crawled on my belly until Alchin expounded on the proper way to exhibit respect in the countenance of omnipotence. I gulp and try not to disgorge my intestinal tract one swollen loop at a time.
But we have heard such great things about you.
He dusts his shoulder with a pale, elegant hand, takes another step nearer. We're practically in sexual harassment territory now. Gods have no concept of personal space.
Rupert Wong, Seneschal of Kuala Lumpur, you have been called by heaven to participate in an investigation of unparalleled importance.
Dimly, my breath clogged with salt and reptilian musk, I catch myself wondering why Mina hasn't come knocking. She must have heard the din. Had Alchin ensorcelled the room? Did he do something?
Repeat after me. I, Rupert Wong, pledge to forfeit eternal respite if I fail at this task, for there is no peace for those who fail heaven's will.
I lick my lips again, ricocheting back to the pants-wetting present. I, Rupert Wong, pledge. You don't say no to a 600-foot-long dragon, Longmaw. Ever. 3. Are those chicken feathers? Alchin narrows his lambent gaze and chuckles, the noise gargling in his throat, almost loud enough to disguise the ticking of his mandibles.
Always the comedian, Wong. Yes, we desire that you seek a chicken worthy of us.
Ah. I run a nervous tongue over my molars, and then try for a grin. It comes out a tortured rictus. Okay. He holds his position. I really, really wish he'd blink. The silence lengthens and lengthens, stretching like filaments of mucus, so heavy with expectations that you could asphyxiate a small pony in the tangle. Alchin is clearly waiting for me to arrive at some important epiphany, and delighting in the fact I don't even have a postcode in mind. I look back down at the box in his hands. Inside, 3 massive feathers on a bed of crushed velvet. Nothing else. No personal effects, no disembodied appendages, no letter of incoherent farewell. The only clue is the rust-brown blood congealed in the plumage. Murder most foul? I ask, careful to emphasize the last word. Irreverent humor is the last bastion of the beleaguered bureaucrat. Alchin says nothing. Crane? The corners of his mouth twitch a millimeter upwards. Phoenix? He cocks his head like a lizard, jerkily. I inhale until my lungs sting. Then, in one spaceless burst, the words mangling together,
Angel? Feng Huang? Garuda? Griffin? Sphinx? Thunderbird? Pegasus? Cannibal Flying Unicorn?
Alchin sighs. An infuriating little sound, somehow both condescending and long-suffering. Honestly, you'd think it was his office that was gutted and maimed, his windows that were chewed up by a localized climatic holocaust. He dips taloned fingers into the box and extracts a feather, holds it up to the pale light of the evening. His face changes then, softens. The can't-be-fucked-with-you-mortals arrogance, the mannequin alienness, even the anglerfish glow of his eyes, it all dims, drowned in a bone-deep, heart-pulping anguish. The sight of it braids ice around my spine. What could possibly hurt something like him?
Here in he is.
Oh. The chill spreads, and suddenly I can't breathe, because I can see my future, and it is written in claret. Greek mythology isn't exactly my forte, but anyone who knows anything about the supernatural know about the furies. The kindly ones, the gracious ones, the motherfucking matrons of vengeance. Oh, I repeat, mushing my face with a hand. You want me to
find out why they killed our youngest child?
His voice is so soft, so human, that it roots me in place. There is something universal about the language of hurt, something about it that makes it impossible not to ache in echo. I look up, mouth filling with half-considered platitudes, in time to see the Dragon King extend a finger and prick the dead center of my forehead. My vision detonates. A jigsaw of body parts, legs split and sucked clean of marrow, arms gnawed down to the white of their tendons, finger bones scattered like dice. I can't look away, won't look away. My throat fills with copper, salty sweetness that brims as pain saws through my tongue. I bite down harder. A foreign thought hammers against my temples. I am a king. I cannot break. Alchin's memories permit only a moment's sliver of personal autonomy, enough to register what is happening. Then they descend again, waves boiling, choking. His rage is volcanic, primal, acid in the arteries. I run our fingers along the arc of an exposed spine. The smell is her. We would recognize it anywhere. This is our child, our youngest, our mate's sweetest and most beloved. We follow the vertebrae up to the flayed line of the throat, to her jaw, the serene bow of her mouth. 8 centuries since we've seen her smile, and we find it now, still luminescent, still beautiful in death. Dimly, we registered the bloodied detritus that was her husband. His face wears its terror. His lips still scream. Strange. So strange. Why did he exhibit his pain, but not our daughter? Perhaps it was her royal lineage that gripped her composure tight as her ribs were cracked open, her chest emptied of lungs and nerve? Perhaps.
We stop ourselves. Such contemplations are merely auxiliary to this horror, this nightmare that we can never remedy. No matter the offerings we heap upon the absent Jade Emperor's lap, our daughter is dead. Our daughter is dead. Our daughter is dead. Dead. Dead.
My lord.
A voice seeps through the thundering mantra of our grief.
You may want to see this.
I'm sorry. I slur the words, gorge rising as the borrowed memory is devoured by the present. Everything is too bright, too loud, too everything. A sensory deluge so acute that even the throb of my pulse overwhelms. My knees buckle, and I sag forward to vomit today's lunch into a waste bin. You have to understand, Ongno, ignoring the fact that it is absolutely jarring to be forced into someone else's mind. Butchery and violence are not synonymous. There's a difference between being able to prepare a Scottish rump roast, yes, it's exactly what you think it is, and being dragged through a stew of phantasmal gore. One is a systematic ecosystem of parts, order translated into cold-cut meats. The other? Far less orderly. Ao Chin's voice unfurls.
We do not require condolences. We require justice, Mr. Wong. We require blood.
Nasal cavities aflame with stomach bile, I wipe my mouth on a sleeve and stand. Push up and unbend, one wobbling leg at a time. The world swims dangerously, but my balance holds. Hysteria quickens my speech.
Look, I'm not going to kill a fury for you. I can't. Not because I don't want to, because Guan Yin knows I'd like nothing more than to keep razor-mouthed gods like you happy. But there is absolutely no physical way I can.
The Dragon King makes a strange, high noise. Over and over, stuttering like a broken VCR, until the sound transmutes into a tooth-grinding wail. It takes me a moment to realize he's laughing.
We do not expect you to kill them, Mr. Wong. We expect you to gather evidence. Ineluctable proof that they performed a crime. We require these materials before we can confront the Greeks.
A little better, but nothing close to ideal. No one likes being treated like a petty criminal. Personal experience goes a long way, Angma. I can't imagine the Furies would appreciate me poking my stubby nose into their business.
But, boss, your highness, sir,
with all due respect, the Furies aren't exactly the kind to act on impulse. History shows that
they killed my daughter.
Ao Chin slams his palms on the table. Wood splinters under the impact. More terrifying than his introductory exhibition of power, than the price tag of his wardrobe, than the hate with which he builds each quiet word, is the absence of the royal pronoun. This is personal for him. Personal in a way I never thought gods could do. Okay, I say again, raising my hands slowly. I get you. Fine. So, just get in,
get whatever you need, get out, and get paid?
Yes.
Okay, I say, for what feels like the 100th time today. I close my eyes and squeeze the flesh along my nose bridge. And what if I don't actually find something?
You will.
Or what? The words escape before I can throttle them in the crib. I freeze, as does Ao Chin. We're both equally shocked by my audacity, I imagine. Your Highness, I understand that you, see your daughter as a paragon of virtue. But hear me out here. What if, hypothetically speaking, the Furies have a close and shut case? If that were the case, what happens to me? Something squirms under Ao Chin's smooth, plaster-white skin. Down through the slant of his left cheekbone, down his nose, down his throat, where it bulges perversely before vanishing from sight. Silence follows, noose tight and pregnant with menace. Without altering expression, Ao Chin clicks the box shut and slides it across the table.
If that were indeed the case,
he begins, gauze light, his enunciation cotton-edged, like someone speaking through the membrane of a dream,
we would be forced to act as though you had failed us.
But an argument about fairness bashes against the back of my teeth. But common sense prevails for a change. Ao Chin's gaze deepens.
We assure you that we thought long and hard about this. Our daughter is faultless. Our daughter would never do anything to incur their wrath. You will find the answer we desire. We are certain of this.
Monosyllabic protests seem to be in vogue, this conversation.
If we had the option, if we could ask one of our own to undertake this quest, we would have. But that isn't possible. Not without risking a war with the Greeks. It has to be you, Rupert Wong.
Unspoken. Human scapegoats are all the rage. Okay. We trade stares. Ao Chin crosses his hands behind the small of his back, eyebrows slightly arched, and nudges the air with an upward thrust of his head, as though rolling a ball into my court. Unwilling to commit just yet, my skin blistering under his scrutiny, I stoop down to harvest bits of smashed pottery, broken glass, and tattered papers. The sloughed-off flesh from the Kuikia. Formaldehyde can only do so much for these acrobatic tykes. I leave for the vacuum. We maintain this rhythm for a while, me cleaning, him observing. A few minutes into my housekeeping, I hear a discreet thud. I look up. A paperweight has been mysteriously returned upright. The unexpected act of nominal charity kindles a weird anger. You can push me around. You can dick with my life. You can raise my rent. But don't pretend you actually care about my well-being. Especially not now, not here. That fury quickly transfigures into ill-guided inspiration. A plan clicks into place, and I stand, giddy with the knowledge I'm about to say something breathtakingly idiotic again. By the by, Your Highness, I was thinking.
I draw a circle in the air with a finger, my other arm looped around the waistpin, its bowels acrid with the stomach bile. Theoretically speaking, if I went to DU and told them that you were press-ganging one of their representatives into unsanctioned service, wouldn't that annul my oath and get you into incredible amounts of legal trouble? The Dragon King cants his skull.
Are you threatening me?
I'm not threatening you, I say, as I deposit my container on the desk, all the while thinking to myself, yes, yes I am. I'm just expressing, in a roundabout way, my desire to not be enslaved by a verbal contract. As much as I'd like the fortune you've promised me, and to avoid the certain death you've been implying, there is no way this is happening. I'm not risking those furies.
Not even for me?
Mina peels from the doorframe, a monochrome palette of what little is good and beautiful in my world. Her feet make no sound, no sound at all. The Longsure Hangma are very good at levitation. As she picks through the wreckage, eyes half-shuttered, Baju Kurung rustling like the waters of a midnight lake.
Mina,
I swallow.
Sayang, you shouldn't be here.
She ignores me. Her attention belongs wholly to Ao Qin, who watches her sinuous approach with a mix of repulsion and wonder. I wonder if he sees a little bit of his daughter in her corpse-pale face, her scar-kissed arms. Eventually, Ao Qin nods, slow and boneless, spine-bending, serpentine supple.
We can grant that boon, dead little girl.
Wait, what are we... In reply, Mina, still stoically ignoring my endeavors to make eye contact, laces her hands about his and bows low, lips pressed reverently to the Dragon King's fingers.
There are no words to convey my gratitude, young Pertuan.
Excuse me? Someone? What are we talking about here?
We will even personally escort you to Mengpo,
continues Ao Qin.
But only if Mr. Wong completes his task.
My ribs immediately become three sizes too tight. Mina was a good girl in life, pious even, the kind who prayed 5 times a day, who paid her zakat without complaint and eschewed the temptations of bacon and expensive liquor. But all that virtuous behavior means nothing when you've suckled on the marrow of your ex-spouse and drained his lover's heart like it was some succulent fruit. Heaven has long ceased being an option for Mina. But reincarnation? That was still a possibility. A dim, distant possibility, like a childhood daydream half-remembered, but still an achievable solution. It would require wading through a storm of red tape, of course, and innumerable court appearances, but it could happen. Especially if you have the backing of an antediluvian deity.
Thank you,
Mina says, her voice so rich with hope and want that I know I've lost before even she turns to fix her beautiful gaze on me. I would do anything for this girl. Anything at all. And they both know this. Fuckers.
We shall be in touch.
I smile weakly and nod. There was nothing else to be said. 4. The sky burns blue as we slouch through the gridlocked highway, the distant city of Kuala Lumpur, a conundrum of skyscrapers, post-colonial architecture, and verdant green jungle. Someone punches their horn furiously. Another car replies with a loud bellow, like a beast answering a challenge. The air conditioning coughs. Once, twice, six times. The mechanical hacking eventually weakens into a background rattle, even as Feng Mun lowers the temperature. Warm air blasts through the vents, smelling of chrysanthemum and exhaust gases. Roar as it might, the cab's emphysemic AC is obviously losing its battle against the wet, torpid heat. As the sun beat down through the right window, I scoot a bit closer to the left, trying in vain to melt into what little shade exists. Don't know why I bother, Hongma. It never works.
So, boss, Feng Mun begins, coy, gap-toothed smile gleaming in the rearview window. Have you talked to my wife recently, huh?
Sorry, haven't had the time, I mumble, in between arranging a plate of offerings and fighting my lighter. I fumble and lose my grip. The cha siu bao bounces onto the floor, gathering dirt and whatever else has collected on the carpeted floor. Hopefully its recipient won't care too much. I don't want to deal with the competition. My cab driver twitches a shoulder, still obnoxiously sunny.
Okay, lo. If you got time, ask her if she have enough money. If not, I can burn more.
Feng Mun is the poster child of modern Minghuns. Where his predecessors married for desperation or to continue a family line, my ex-colleague, no one stays in the triads forever, Hong Ma, married his ghost. I'm being literal again, yes, for love. According to rumor, all it took was a single black-and-white photo, and then 6 years of bush-beating, nail-gnawing, long-distance courtship. If this were a Shakespearean performance, Feng Mun would have killed himself for her ages ago, possibly while ululating about his affections. But the two are practical, earthen folk. His wife, Su Lin, was a prodigal accountant. Such a transgression, she pointed out, would have doomed him to a lower strata of DU, invalidating the whole gesture. So they're both waiting for his natural demise, trading messages through mediums and affection through willing possessees. Yes, I know, Hong Ma, very unsettling. But they're happy, and the mediums get paid. Who are we to judge? Okay. I drain a bottle of mineral water in a single motion, chuck it onto the floor as I ignite a trifecta of red joss sticks. The air immediately clots with the smell of sandalwood, nauseatingly dense. But the god of missing people mandates such excess. Anything else, and you're asking for paper cuts. At least, that's my assumption. My comprehension of Taoist sorcery is only very minimally superior to my grasp of animistic magic, which is to say, I really, really should be chaperoned by an adult at all times and kept away from the complicated ideas. I have no aptitude for the mystic arts, only pig-headed resolution and a vague certainty that knowing how to contact the people I work with is a valuable trait. It gets you somewhere. Far, unfortunately, isn't one of those destinations. Is it okay if I roll down the... I clutch the lever in anticipation. Feng Mun's car is a geriatric embarrassment in every way, except for the engine purring beneath the bumblebee yellow hood. Feng Mun's voice booms, bright and boisterous, only slightly damaged by the scar rippling from mouth to clavicle.
Can! For you, anything also okay.
squeak, squeak, squeal, crunch.
The contraption jams.
Push harder, la,
he chortles. On the radio, Taylor Swift's static-mauled voice rises in volume, imploring listeners to shake it off, shake it off. I throw my shoulder into the motion, just as a torn-out scrap of newspaper glides through the pinprick gap between window and doorframe. Another follows. Then another. And another. Another. Missing people notices. Kidnapping reports. Public entreaties to return a beloved son, a cherished daughter. An entire river of cheap newsprint washes into the cab, swilling together into a vaguely humanoid shape.
Don't block my mirror, can or not?
Feng Moon shoots glibly, immune to the strangeness. Outside, the driver of a passing proton wira gawks, slack-jawed, until I stare him down. Eyes, all the black of the darkest inks, all young, all excerpts from lives interrupted, narrow as they flutter past. Mouths gape, hiss like cats.
Really, Rupert?
They grumble in perfect unison, their Cantonese accented and musical.
Of all the places in Kuala Lumpur, of all the happening joints you could have invited me to, you had to call me here?
Hey, what's wrong with my taxi, ah?
Feng Moon drapes an elbow over the back of his seat and cranes a look backwards. He waggles a finger.
I clean it every day, you know.
He does. I pinch the bridge of my nose. Look, can we argue about this later? I'm trying to do business here. The god of missing people lounges back in its seat. The faces on its skin, too young, much too young, murmur among themselves, their gazes darting this way and that, a gaggle of gossiping relatives at Chinese New Year. Seconds later, they stop, all at once, and focus on me.
Fine.
Hundreds of eyes, some visible, some walled up behind text-scarred creases, roll with teenage extravagance.
First, let's see the goods.
I wedge a smile onto my mouth and try to maintain eye contact with the countenances papered around its head, a feat complicated by their reluctance to do the same. My mood lifts, however, when a corkscrew-haired girl of about 16 shares a wink. Good sign. Definitely. Definitely, maybe. Impaling the joysticks on a doughy chas yu bao, I nudge the offerings forward. The response this time is unmistakably favorable. The god of missing people, cooing in chorus with itself, trails fingers of cheap paper around the spread, round and round in languid figures of eight, over and over and over. With every orbit, the food begins to gray, rotting from the inside out. Mold settles like muslin over the decay, and the deity sighs orgasmically to itself.
Delicious, it croons. You never fail to impress. You have no idea how many people call me up without even sparing a thought about what I want, or what I like, or...
The god stops. Despite the tropical sun, I feel the ambient temperature drop several degrees, sinking to somewhere between reasonable chance of doom and unequivocal disgruntlement. I pluck at my collar. Yes?
I extend the word like an olive branch, half in wistful fatalism. It's obviously that there's no hand waiting to receive it, just a colony of hornets. But optimism is stubborn. The god of missing people doesn't answer. Not at first. I watch with growing unease as its mouth works in furious silence, like an old woman in mortal conflict with a glob of toffee. Eventually, it discharges a wad of hair and gum and chewed-up plastic wrappers into a cupped palm before presenting the offending bezoar for examination. Not my fault! The exclamation bubbles out before I can stop it. I sound like an obtuse toddler. I'm too busy squashing the temptation to ask about the exact logistics of what just happened to be properly tactful. Somewhere between all that, a manic thought arises. It wasn't as though the deity had actually eaten the cha siu bao.
"You'd think, Rupert," the god says, almost hyperventilating at this point, every word swaddled with venom, every sentence an octave above the last, "you'd think that you, of all people, would understand the importance of curating an offering. It's not like I asked for much. Not like your old gods with their virgins and golden calves. But I... more excuses?"
Now its voice is vibrating.
"You should be down on your knees right now, thanking me for being so benevolent. Why, I can't imagine how..."
A sigh whooshes free before I can reel it back. There's no hope for it. Persnickety gods don't stop once they've started steamrolling down their preferred tangent. I wait for an opening to repost, misguided as that notion might be, and finally find one as Feng Moon eases us into a three-lane stalemate. "I'm really, really sorry." Hardly the most macho rejoinder, but humility is never a bad place to start. "It was entirely an accident. I did not mean offense. If there's any way I could..."
"You could ask someone else to be your bloodhound," it sniffs. "Damn it, damn it, damn it, damn it."
"We'll be even after that?" The god of missing people twists its head, arms crossing, every visible face puckered with low-key distaste. Something nasty feeds into its body language. This is probably not going to be something I appreciate.
"Yes, but only if you let me watch."
"Nope." "Cruelty is next to godliness," I mutter under my breath, but I extend my hand, palm up, wrist bared. With more practice than I care to admit, I slide a razor from its expertly sewn, Mina has a dreadful amount of free time, pocket in my inner sleeve. The blade itself is nothing terribly noteworthy, a plain wedge of stainless steel about the size of my thumb. Nonetheless, it suits its purpose. I mumble a string of homemade incantations beneath my breath, spitballing new flourishes to the beat of my own breath. Contrary to pop culture, magic prefers invention to ritual, so long as you adhere to the fundamentals, that is. You can't grill a steak without meat, after all. Or pull ghosts from the road without a tribute of blood. Failure to get the basic tenets right invariably results in stickiness. Anyway, halfway through the polysyllabic maelstrom, I stab the blade into my forearm.
pain fountains, and for the second time in 24 hours, the world fractures into a Dali-esque painting, all melting colors and insane configurations, shapes eating shapes, faces.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.